print?
Well, I think it first starts with acknowledging that we're in this state of undeclared emergency. You know, we have North Korea firing off ballistic missiles, North Korean soldiers now in the front with Ukraine. We've had a pogrom in Israel. We have the Russians providing targeting information to the Houthis to hold 15% of world trade hostage. You know, what more would we have to see to actually kind of mobilize? And so looking at that, we have a couple weeks of weapons on hand for the China fight. We see that Ukraine expended 10 years of production in 10 weeks. And so are we ready? Are we doing everything? And when I look back at our history, how did we win World War II? How did we win the Cold War? We didn't have a defense industrial base. We had an American industrial base. 94% of spending on major weapon systems did not go to defense companies. It went to dual purpose companies. Chrysler made cars and missiles. Ford made satellites until 1990. General Mills, the cereal company, made artillery. The very laydown of our economy was so different. Every car, camera, and cereal box you bought enhanced our national security. Unfortunately, that's what China's doing to us. Only 30% of their defense company revenue even comes from the PLA. The rest comes from us buying cheap knickknacks on Amazon.
Isn't it telling how much has changed in the structure of industry since then? If the global landscape is heating up this fast, could our current approach be limiting our readiness? With China integrating national security into every product they make, are we underestimating the need for that same adaptability?
So what's the way to fix this? Is it reimagining incentives, Shyam? How do we fix it?
I think so. I think the talk track since the end of the Cold War is really that, you know, we consolidate our industrial base. We don't have enough competition amongst the industrial base. That may be true, certainly not my lived experience. I think the real problem is we gave up on competition within government. When we were building the ICBM program, it was the Navy, the Army, and the Air Force competing against each other to make the very best product. When we were building the submarine launched ballistic missiles, we had four competing programs inside the Navy itself. Today, we would find that wasteful, duplicative. We grant these monopolies, you know, which actually, if you really step back and squint at it, that looks like central planning and communism. We're saying there's just one approved way of doing this. And I think at a deep fundamental level, we believe in competition as a country. We believe in the innovation that comes from the free market. You know, and what excites me, like what catalyzed me to really write this right now, is that the founders are back. You know, I think the consequence of the Defense Last Supper in 1993, where we started this consolidation, is that we drove the innovators and the entrepreneurs out of the sector.
It's such a big part of American defense history. Historic mavericks, innovators, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Like we think about it today as Northrop Grumman, but it was Leroy Grumman and Jack Northrop. It wasn't Northrop Grumman. It wasn't the institution. It was these people. It's folks like Palmer Luckey and Elon Musk. It's folks like Alex Karp. This is how we're going to resurrect the American industrial base.
It's a powerful point. Competition within government as the catalyst for innovation. Have we forgotten the value of this rivalry? By consolidating to this extent, are we unintentionally holding back the very breakthroughs that used to define American defense? With the return of bold founders, could this be a chance to reinvigorate that spirit of relentless internal competition?
So we have an election. Do you look at the candidate, Shyam, and say, one more than the other, Trump or Harris, it would be more open to reimagining the DoD in the way that you're kind of suggesting here?
Well, I think broadly, both sides, this is very much a bipartisan issue. People see the problems that we're facing here. But it really starts with leadership, which is, I think, maybe, you know, not something you'd expect a technologist to say. I don't think technology is going to magically save us here. When Admiral Rickover was building the nuclear Navy, he was in that seat for 30 years. Mm. John Boyd was the father of the F-16. Who's the father of the F-35, the $2 trillion F-35 with 30% availability? It was designed by committee. It's run by committee. It's been, you know, 3 decades in design and development. There's a mechanism that was really working. And I think having become the world superpower, we kind of turned our back on all the mechanisms that we actually used to win. And so we have a very clear blueprint that's actually based on our past. But I think one thing that's very clear is that we have to reindustrialize. And as a country, we have to reimagine how we're going to industrialize. And I see that, you know, half of our business is about helping companies build cars, planes, trains, ships, bending atoms better with bits. And to do this, we have to give American workers superpowers. You know, we can't compete symmetrically with China. At the dawn of World War II, we were the best at mass production. Today, our adversary is. So what is David's slingshot in doing this? Well, we are the world's best by a yawning margin at software. Mm. And so we have to use our AI advantage to bring automation and let's call it an Iron Man suit for American workers.
Isn't it fascinating that our greatest asset today isn't in factories, but in code? If we're leveraging AI to empower our workforce, could we become the modern day arsenal of democracy? Rather than matching China's production, Can we redefine what it means to be a manufacturing superpower by amplifying each worker's impact through technology?
Exactly. Tesla, SpaceX. I mean, we've been working with Panasonic Energy to make every battery in the Tesla Gigafactory in Reno, and they are giving their workers super. They're not using exquisite Japanese engineers. They're making every American as effective as an exquisite Japanese engineer.
A question about that, Sean, is, listen, neither candidate wants to address this country's fiscal challenges, which are serious. At some point, you actually might have to get spending under control. Any concern that at some point there may be a haircut to defense spending and how that could ripple effect, you know, Palantir and others?
Well, I don't think this is a spending problem. I think we are spending, we have plenty of money to go after this. It's how we're spending it that we need to really look at. I would say that with the caveat that we are actually spending at historic lows. You know, we are spending, I think, roughly 2.7% of GDP. If we look back at what is the cost of ensuring our national security, which exists as a means of underwriting our economic prosperity and individual liberties, it is at a historic low. So I'm not saying it needs to go up. I'm just saying it would be good for the pot, because we see this big flagship number and it seems scary, but we have to actually understand it's relatively small.
It's striking that the issue might not be the amount we're spending, but how effectively we're using those funds. If national security underpins economic stability, could smarter allocation, rather than simply increasing budgets, be the real key to sustaining both our defense and prosperity?
Relative to GDP.
Yes.
Right. Let me ask you, I saw this interesting article, you saw it too in the Journal, this new DoD initiative. And the whole idea here, let's recruit top tech talent to join the reserves. You're part of that, it sounds like. Walk me through what's going on there, Sean.
I'd say in the past, we had a much closer relationship there between the civil and military sectors. When George Marshall was putting together the Marshall Plan, he really called up all of his friends who were the captains of industry. What I see and what I learned from the early days of the Israel conflict, when they mobilized 360,000 reservists, when they went back into the IDF, they were horrified at the state of technology. And that is an exceptionally technical country. Mm-hmm. So that is an implicit self-critique saying, wow, now that I'm 20 years more experienced than I was when I was a conscript, I've learned so much from industry. I've built these internet scale applications. I would do this differently. They modernized more in the 4 months afterwards than in the 10 years prior. And so we have this natural resource in this country in spades, not just in the software field, but in hardware manufacturing and in industrials and power. How do we bring that talent base? There is a people industrial base aspect of this and creating more fluidity for people to be able to serve in these capacities.
I was also, did you think it sort of reflects this broader trend or shift? I mean, of technologists, tech entrepreneurs wanting to and embracing the U.S. military, wanting to work with the military? Is that a shift?
That is a, you know, I've been doing this for 20 years, and I'd say it's a
wasn't always like
shift.
That.
It was the opposite of that. And I think that it's very clear now that people want to serve. They're not taking this for granted anymore. It is a sea change from what it was a decade.
Why is that, Sean? What did change?
I think the world changed around us. Like there was a fair amount of self-loathing in the country of what is going on here, but we see what's happening in Ukraine. We recognize that, you know, just because we were the global superpower, maybe the end of history didn't really happen, and everything that we're able to do as technologists, the economic freedom that we have is earned. It's not a birthright.
It's powerful to see this shift, where tech leaders feel a renewed responsibility to serve. As global tensions rise, it seems like there's a broader realization that security and economic freedom aren't guaranteed, but something that needs ongoing commitment. Could this blend of tech and defense be the key to safeguarding the future?
Let me ask you, I want to get you out of there, Sean. So earnings are coming up. I know you got to be careful. I am interested, though, as you look ahead now, 2024, your stock has roared, right? As you look to 2025, what's next for Palantir? What excites you?
What really excites me is the continued adoption of AI across the U.S. commercial sector, where people are rolling up their sleeves and getting busy implementing it. And what I see as a broad theme is you can kind of think of AI as there's two parts of it. There's the AI supply, the model side, and people are investing a lot in building these models. But if you take a step back and look at it, while the models are improving, both the closed models and the open models are getting more similar. So they're getting smarter, but more similar to each other. And if you look at the demand side, we've been uniquely positioned. This technology that we call the ontology, which other people are starting to notice now, is a prerequisite to being able to harness AI for economic value in the enterprise. We put into production a 78 AI agent model to automate insurance underwriting. That's a very regulated field. The regulators have to sign off on that. It changes the process from taking 2 weeks to 3 hours. Now, the first order benefit people mostly think of, they're like, oh, wow, that's a significant labor savings. Actually, yes, there is labor savings. The real savings, though, is the strategic dislocation in the market. If your competitors still take 2 weeks to underwrite risk and you're taking 3 hours, you're going to go eat the market.
Palantir's trajectory is truly reshaping industries with AI that's practical and transformative. By cutting underwriting from 2 weeks to 3 hours, they're not just optimizing operations, they're disrupting the playing field entirely. Imagine the ripple effect when speed, efficiency, and strategic advantage converge like this. The question is, as these AI-driven shifts take root, who will keep up with this pace of change?